Fresh water is a basic human right. And yet people in East Otago can't drink their tap water months after lead was detected in it. It's put the toxic heavy metal back on our radar. Lead was phased out of our paint and petrol decades ago. But as Tania Page discovers, everyday products like taps are still coming into the country and leaching lead into our water. And those products could be in your home.
Your pink one?
Those ones are yellow.
If you could know your child is being poisoned and that that might harm them, don't parents want to know that?
Thank you. Thanks for sharing.
Who's most at risk?
Young children. Lead paint tastes sweet, so kids will eat it.
I think everybody would want to know if their baby is potentially being brain damaged so they can do something about it.
It can affect their IQ, it may impact on their hearing, and it may impact on how tall they grow. It has also been linked with some behavioural difficulties in children as well because of the impacts on their brains.
Are you going to eat a biscuit or drink some milk?
Ananda and Graham would do anything to keep their kids safe.
Do you want some more pineapple, Francis?
But they never thought their dream home would turn out to be such a nightmare.
When you bought this place, what did you love about it?
We were just lucky to be able to buy a house, period. But we also were just really excited to be able to get one in a nice neighbourhood and a really beautiful old house.
In Gisborne.
It's a great size with a great yard. There's just so many good things about it.
And one really bad thing.
In our house, where do we find it? Everywhere.
Lead. Lots of it.
We found it in our carpet, in our door frames, and our doors. It was in our window frames, in our ceiling, and behind our walls. It was in a lot of places.
Starting with the lead light windows.
I was trying to find out what would happen if they got broken. And through that search, realized that the lines in the lead lights are actually lead. In Berkeley, he was about 9 months old at the time, used to play right here.
The lead oxidizes over time.
Anything that's on a baby's hands is going to be ingested, and that's a really big risk.
When lead is ingested or inhaled, it enters your bloodstream and is stored in your bones. Lead is a cumulative poison, meaning it can build up in your body over time. In children, it can affect both their mental and physical development. In adults, it can affect the nervous system and cause gastrointestinal problems. And in rare cases, lead poisoning can kill.
The whole house used to be carpeted.
And these windows were in all the front rooms.
The lead that's in the windows, it's constantly just dusting down little bits of lead over time. And even if you vacuum it all up, you'll never get all of it out. Graham, my husband, thought I was being a bit paranoid about the whole thing. We sent 2 vacuum dust samples to the lab to be analyzed, and when they came back really high, then Graham realized, like, whoa, I definitely have a problem here that we have to deal with.
As you were starting to find all of this out as a mum of young kids, how did you feel?
It's awful looking around and thinking your entire house is poisoning your kids. It's really upsetting.
Getting ready to take off.
The couple decided to get the boys' blood tested. That was in 2019, when the notifiable level here for lead in blood was 0.48 micromoles per litre, twice as high as the notifiable level in the US of 0.24. Berkeley, then just a baby, had a reading of 0.23.
At the time, nobody cared, but we knew that that was not okay.
In April this year, New Zealand halved the notifiable level, bringing us into line with Ananda's homeland, the US.
People often think if it's below that notifiable level, then it's safe. But there's no safe level of lead in children. And so the fact that his was just a hair below the notifiable level didn't mean it was any less to us.
Globally, the approach to lead has changed in recent years.
International authorities like the World Health Organization have moved toward the ALARA principle, A-L-A-R-A, as low as reasonably achievable.
Why did that change happen?
More information coming in around potential effects, partly because it depends on age, developmental stage, It's very hard to set a threshold with lead to say, above this, everything's okay.
Sally Gore is Director of Environmental Science at the University of Canterbury.
So you know about the first flush effect. I have an interest in how people are exposed to contaminants and what happens when contaminants go into the environment.
She heads a research group of postgraduate students.
It keeps you young. I really enjoy the energy and the enthusiasm. I have lots of marking, so much marking.
Sally and her students have been testing the level of lead in soil using an XRF gun.
This is a quick screening technique that we can do, which is good for identifying areas where there might be a contamination issue.
How does it work?
There's a beam of X-rays that go into the ground, and the metals that are present will then send light back. So this will give us an approximate concentration of what's present in the soil.
What does it show?
347 milligrams per kilogram.
So that exceeds the residential level.
How we build for the future is the standard by which our children will judge us.
Widely used in house paint until the 1960s, lead was gradually phased out, and by the 90s, licks of paint didn't come with a side of lead.
However, I don't think we should focus on the age of the house. We also need to consider the age of the neighbourhood. This is a site where there used to be housing, and what I wanted to demonstrate is that even if the houses are gone, then the lead still remains. The levels of lead that we are finding are consistent with what people have been reporting across the country.
Does our love for DIY put us in danger?
Potentially, if it's not done well. And if it's not done well, you can also put the neighbours in danger, because you're busily sanding away and the dust moves next door.
Ananda and Graham's dream bungalow was built in 1929.
So is there only a lead issue in the house?
No.
They had their soil tested as well.
The veggie box was almost 300.
The allowable level of lead in urban soil is 210 milligrams per kilogram.
Under the agapanthus was over 2,000. In the front of the house, that was higher than 3,000. We did a grid of pretty much the entire lawn, and all of it was contaminated.
It's everywhere. Ananda, a stay-at-home mum, is a molecular biologist. Graham, a project manager, holds a PhD in biology. They moved to Gisborne for a change of pace.
This whole back section used to be exterior.
When you were doing your research, was it easy to find good information?
No, it was so hard. Inside all of these walls is weatherboards with super high levels of lead paint on them.
We thought maybe there would be lead abatement companies, people to come and test, like assessors. There was nothing. I was able to find one guy, an environmental consultant, and he was just invaluable for us.
And how have you found the attitude of tradespeople to lead?
They don't have any idea. Most would not know how to treat lead safely, and their standard mode of operating would put families at risk.
Taking every possible precaution, Graham did the work himself.
Then the boys and I moved into our motorhome, and Graham started renovating, and that was really hard, living with two little guys in a camper van for a month.
Their house is now safe to live in.
So how did you make the window safe?
So Graham built these wooden frames with glass in them, so it's just completely encased.
But lead can be found in other places too.
These are all plates for my kitchen. What we're looking at here is to see whether there's lead in the glaze.
Today, Sally has swapped soil for some of her vintage crockery.
Would you please test this one, because my mum has one of these.
Might just be a good dry biscuit plate.
Doesn't look good.
2.7?
Percent.
So is that good or bad?
That's not great. It wouldn't be an everyday plate. I wouldn't put anything acidic on it, lemon juice or fruit or a vinaigrette, because that will leach the lead out.
I will tell my mother.
So there are lots of potential ways in which someone could be exposed to lead and have no idea.
Yes.
Fresh, clean water, it's a basic human need. But here in East Otago, residents haven't been allowed to drink theirs since February. after elevated levels of lead were detected in the local water supply.
I'll take that one.
That's a bit mean.
Mick and Avril Lewis moved to Waikouaiti about 3 years ago.
That's 2 points. I'm a winner.
It's a nice place, I'd recommend it, apart from the water.
Avril thought it tasted muddy, so Mick installed a roof water tank.
Should be three.
But he was happy to drink from the kitchen tap.
It tastes okay to me, but all the water I drink has got one coffee and two sugars in it.
As soon as they heard about the lead spikes, Mick and Avril got their blood tested. The notifiable limit is now 0.24 micromoles per litre.
I was high at 0.28, which is over the limit. And Avril had no lead detected. I was drinking the water, I was high, she had none.
Remember, Avril has never drunk the local water, and Mick switched to their roof tank supply in February. His blood lead level has now come down.
When I was retested after 90 days, it had dropped 15%. My only treatment was not drinking the water. Anything being watered wasn't doing well.
Mick says he never felt sick, but he did lose weight, a symptom of lead poisoning.
I lost a couple of kgs, yeah, just leading up to Christmas. I couldn't explain the weight lost. I was just doing what I've always done. As the lead left my body, the weight came back.
The largest lead spike was recorded in early December, the same month that Mick noticed his potato crops were dying.
The potatoes were in two rows here, and they simply turned yellow and then died. Very simply, the more water you put on, the more lead was in the ground. Mm.
This is the Waikouaiti Water Treatment Plant. People around here haven't been able to drink the water from it for over 4 months. Stressed and frustrated, some whānau have paid for their own tests. This one, a pre-flush result from April, shows the level of lead in the main supply was 11 times higher than the allowable limit.
While Dunedin City Council are yet to release their findings into the cause of the lead spikes, Mick is in no doubt about who's to blame.
I immediately rang the council to ask when the pipe on our street was actually last flushed. And they says we don't flush that pipe because the pipe's that knackered, we're frightened it'll collapse.
Since then, he says the pipes have been flushed and they're being replaced earlier than planned.
I think they're covering up their sloppy management and the lack of work on the infrastructure out here. It's as simple as that.
A report into the public health response in East Otago recommended a review of tapware standards, a move strongly supported by master plumbers.
That's the problem with that one, it's got no brand on it.
Greg Wallace is the chief executive.
How many have you tested, like, installed?
He wants New Zealand to aim for zero lead in its drinking water, something Australia is now considering.
We got lead out of petrol, we got it out of paint. Surely we want it out of our drinking water.
Lead can build up in our water overnight, which is why it's recommended to flush your kitchen tap first thing every morning.
We're asking consumers to waste water by running their tap 30 seconds every day of their life before they use that tap. The solution to us is very simple. We just remove lead from tapware and brass plumbing items so that contamination cannot occur.
He also wants taps to be tested and approved through a mandatory product labelling scheme so consumers and plumbers can have confidence in the tap being installed.
They're receiving sometimes a white, unmarked box. The instructions aren't in English. There's no way to verify that product is safe for installation. And that onus is all put on the installer. And we think that should be on the importer and supplier of the product.
And this is your own testing kit?
This is our own testing kit.
Reuben Cutts is a master plumber. He's taken a sample of tap water.
What we're going to do now is grab our second solution.
For a 10-minute lead test.
And add 5 drops to that.
We accept the testing is narrow, but we also expect that the government and the regulator should be doing testing themselves. And that just hasn't occurred.
We're basically mixing this around for 20 seconds.
Okay.
New Zealand's current drinking water standard is 10 micrograms per litre.
Well, that has given us a reading of 74.
74? So that's 7 times over. Wow.
7.5, yeah.
There are two more surprises to come. The tap that water came from was tested and approved in Australia.
So this is it.
Okay, this is the one that failed.
Yep, so this is the watermark code.
And the final result from an accredited lab is even higher, 11 times over.
I'm shocked by that result.
Does that lessen your faith in the Australian testing system?
Look, I still think the Australian system is better than what we have, which is a non-existent system. But Australia are likely to move to zero lead, and we need to be doing the same.
Is that something you'd consider?
It's certainly something that we want to add to the conversation. It does speak to our real intention to have safe drinking water.
Building Minister Portal Williams.
The tapware has to meet a standard.
It's really easy online to buy tapware that results in a high level of lead. How will the Building Amendment Act prevent that?
Well, the piece of work that we've just passed in the House is designed to do just that. We're requiring manufacturers and suppliers to disclose what is exactly in their products.
Will MB be doing any of its own testing?
No, we're not requiring them to do that.
So you'll be hoping that the standard is met?
We'll be requiring that the standard is met.
But how can you be certain that the information provided is accurate if you're not doing any testing?
We would be expecting our suppliers to supply safe products.
I think their nervousness is around the potential costs. You've got to weigh that cost up with public health.
There are hundreds of thousands of products that go into our buildings. And cost is a factor, and it's important to note that we really do believe that the Building Act will ensure that the products that they provide and the products that are installed are safe.
Plumbing products deal with public health. We're not the same as a screw, a nail, or a piece of plasterboard. This is drinking water.
Every time we have a contamination issue, it is quite a shock to people. We've learnt a lot of lessons from the past. Can we please not repeat them again? Because there are many things that we allow now that possibly in 10 or 20 years people will think, what on earth were they thinking?
And is lead one of those things?
I would like to think not.
Whee!
Berkeley and Francis love playing in their big backyard.
Ready?
But their little sister Rosemary has to watch from the window.
Tell me when to shoot. Shoot.
Because Ananda and Graham can't afford to remove the lead-contaminated soil.
She can't play outside at all until she's past that stage of putting everything in her mouth.
With lead, it's invisible. There's no way to know the harm from it. It doesn't happen for years down the line.
This must be taking a real toll on you.
2 years of renovations plus a new baby. We are exhausted. I think our marriage has taken a bit of a hit because it's just so much stress.
But it helps to share what she's learned about how to keep her kids safe.
Nice, Francis.
Berkeley's level was below the notifiable level, but if we didn't know what the hazards are and we'd let him eat soil outside, it could have been a huge level without us realizing it. A low level exposure over a long period of time is still gonna be just as bad as having a high one.
Oh, go on, shoot! Go!
There will be some people who'll think you've just totally overreacted.
Yeah, I think those people are not aware of the facts.
What do you think the scope of the problem is in New Zealand?
I don't think we fully know.
In East Otago, 38 people, including two children, had notifiable blood lead levels. While consistent with national data, which doesn't include children under five, New Zealand's blood lead levels are higher than the US.
One of the reasons may be regulatory focus. The other potential reason is that we've removed lead and petrol later than other countries did.
So what should our approach to lead be?
I think cautious rather than extremely worried. I think we should be more proactive, both in raising awareness, in giving people tools so they can protect themselves and their families. I live in a 118-year-old house. We always put in raised garden beds. So we bring in the soil and we know what's in it. Definitely no backyard chickens. They eat earthworms, earthworms eat the soil. If you've got small children, that might be a really good place to have your deck or your patio. So you cover it. I'd also like to see a little bit more being done in the drinking water space. It's likely that we will have other areas in New Zealand where lead levels may not necessarily be what we would want them to be in people's drinking water.
So, Sunday understands that Dunedin City Council plan to release their report this month. Now, the watermark tap in our story was one of five random taps purchased online and tested. Three of them failed. So MB, the ministry responsible for investigating non-compliant products, was notified of those results the following business day and before we interviewed the minister. Want to know more? Well, information on Ananda's lead awareness campaign is on our Facebook page, and you'll also find advice on how you can get your soil tested for free in a nationwide study.